in Mariupol, all of them are hostages.
Then the Trump effect. The former president pushes Republican candidates in Ohio's Senate race further to the right. The latest example of polarized politics in the U.S. And the state of the unions, how a labor vote at an Amazon warehouse in New York City has become a catalyst for organizing efforts nationwide. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
It's the little things. The reminders of what's important. It's why Fidelity dedicated advisors are here to help you create a wealth plan. A plan with tax-sensitive investing strategies. Planning focused on tomorrow, while you focus on today. That's the planning effect from Fidelity.
The rules of business are being reinvented with a more flexible workforce, by embracing innovation, by looking not only at current opportunities, but ahead to future ones.
People who know BDO.
The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The first evacuations from a steel plant in Mariupol, the site of a last stand by Ukrainian troops, continue today at an excruciatingly slow pace. Meanwhile, in Moscow, Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov ignited a rhetorical firestorm, saying in an interview that Adolf Hitler had Jewish heritage when asked how Russia could claim to be denazifying Ukraine. The remark was widely denounced, most forcefully in Israel, which summoned the Russian ambassador for an explanation. In Washington, Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer took to the Senate floor.
Mr. Lavrov's comments are just sickening and deserve to be condemned by all who oppose the dangers of anti-Semitism. They tap into the very old and very poisonous notion that the Jewish people themselves were the architects of the worst human atrocities of modern history, even when they were aimed at Jews themselves. Mr. Foreign Minister, you're fooling no one.
President Zelensky also denounced the remarks. He is Jewish, and some of his relatives were killed in the Holocaust. Elsewhere in Ukraine, a missile strike hit the port city of Odessa in the southwest of the country. But the focus remains on the hellscape that is Mariupol in the far southeast and the drive to get its people out. From Ukraine, Nick Schifrin begins our coverage.
2 months of hiding, endless negotiations, and a mile-long convoy emerges from the heart of darkness. Above all, relief for families who didn't know whether they would live or die, didn't have access to the outside world. They cowered in the basement of Mariupol's massive Azovstal steel plant, the final hideout for civilians and soldiers from Russia's bombardment. Those same Russians released this footage today inside Russian-occupied territory of the people they'd besieged, describing horrors inflicted on lives and homes. Olga Savina is 65.
There is no house anymore. Of course there isn't.
Ukrainian soldiers released their own video, helping civilians emerge from the plant and walking through devastation. Some are barely older than the war. They drive past decimated landscapes and are handed over to the UN and ICRC, who walked them across no man's land. But tonight, Russians blocked them from entering Ukrainian territory. And back in Mariupol, more than 100,000 residents still trapped.
130,000 citizens that are still in Mariupol, all of them are hostages.
Sergei Orlov is Mariupol's deputy mayor. We spoke to him by Skype from the nearest Ukrainian-held city, Zaporizhia.
They do not allow them to evacuate to Ukrainian-controlled territory. They continue deportation of our citizens. You know that in our estimation, about 40,000 citizens are deported to Russia, and it's genocide. It's absolute genocide. Russia wants to continue this deportation just to kill Ukraine as a nation.
Orlov sent us photos from Mariupol from the last few days. Families with no electricity, natural gas, heating, or water, and of the cars they used to escape, damaged by relentless Russian shelling. No family left unspared.
You and I have spoken multiple times over the last few months, and you've said that you haven't been able to reach your own family. Have you been able to talk to them since?
They moved all this way through temporary occupied territory through Russia, and unfortunately my father died on this way in Russia.
I'm so sorry to hear that. My condolences.
Thank you.
And so what's the future of Mariupol under these conditions? Is there any?
We absolutely sure that we will return. We will return our Ukrainian Mariupol. Of course, it's totally destroyed, but we will rebuild them.
A nation of resilience, but also of refugees. The UN today said 5.5 million have left their homes and country. The majority fled to Poland, where today's Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, met Polish President Andrzej Duda one day after an unannounced trip to Kyiv to see Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky and promised long-term U.S. support.
America stands with Ukraine. We stand with Ukraine until victory is won.
T-shirts were here?
In the western city of Lviv, the U.S. Acting Ambassador Kristina Kavin returned to Ukraine for the first time since evacuating 6 weeks ago.
Did you see this one?
She went shopping, and her press attaché bought a T-shirt with Ukrainian soldiers' message to the invaders early in the war. Russian warship, go yourself.
I mean, the Ukrainians basically saying, no, we're not going to back down just because you're aiming your guns at us. You know, we're going to stand up for our country. We're going to stand up for the sovereignty of our nation, and you can go do something else if you don't like that.
Afterward, we sat down in Lviv's Market Square.
You were last here in Ukraine on February 22nd. Why have you returned today?
Well, my security professionals have determined that it's safe to come, and we wanted to come as soon as we could, and so I'm back here today. And what we very much hope is that it's signaling a return first to Lviv, but then ultimately to Kyiv. So we're working hard to get there and hope to do that by the end of the month.
Let's talk about arms support and weapons going into Ukraine. The U.S., of course, has been sending artillery that's crucial for the fight in eastern Ukraine. Do you know if that artillery has arrived in eastern Ukraine so that the Ukrainians can use it against Russians in that territory?
Right. So we did recently say that we would provide howitzers, and over half of those have already reached Ukraine. I don't know where each individual one is located in the country, but I know that they're headed where they're needed. And we got them here as quickly as possible so that Ukraine could defend itself against Russia's attacks in the east.
The U.S. is refusing to provide Ukraine some longer range artillery that the Ukrainians have requested. Why is that?
I don't think that we put any sort of cap or limit on the range of our systems. I think we've just been providing what we can quickly that the Ukrainians could be trained on quickly, because of course if they can't use the equipment, it's not as useful.
How does the U.S. define victory in this war?
Ultimately, it's up for Ukraine to define victory, but obviously an independent Ukraine with its own government, the same government that's in power now, and peace. And we'll let Ukraine determine exactly what that victory looks like, because we don't want to presuppose for them any discussions they may be having.
The British government has started talking publicly about victory, including Ukraine evicting Russia from all of Ukraine. That includes eastern Donbass, where the Russians have occupied since 2014. Does the U.S. agree with that?
Crimea and Donbass are Ukraine. And if Ukraine chooses to defend its own territory, I don't think that we would have something negative to say about that.
With all due respect, it sounds like there is no definition of victory that the U.S. government's willing to make.
Well, we don't want to impose upon Ukraine what the victory is. It's really up to Ukrainians to decide if and when they want to make any sort of concession to Russia, and we leave it to them to lay those guidelines out.
Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi, of course, yesterday used the word victory, but also Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin said the U.S. goal is to weaken Russia's ability to wage war. Is that a sign the U.S. aims are expanding?
Well, I would say that Russia has clearly shown itself to be a very bad global actor. So while what they're doing in Ukraine is horrible, horrific, they obviously have other countries that they border. Therefore, given the incredibly irresponsible behavior of President Putin, I think it's a pretty, let's say the idea that he can't do this to other countries and his border countries is certainly a valid one. And a weakened Russia would have a harder time of doing that in other border areas.
And when you say weakened Russia, is that, as Secretary Blinken has said, strategic defeat long term, including sanctions, including export controls, and or military defeat on the battlefield that would actually set Russia's military back multiple years?
Well, first of all, I would say we want Ukraine to win. And to win, they need to defeat Russia. So yes, I would say that there is a military component to that. But frankly, I don't see us removing sanctions or helping Russia out economically if it is not behaving as a good global actor. So if they want to be another North Korea, another Iran, another Syria that is completely isolated in the world where no one will trade, then, they've chosen that path, and as long as they continue to act in the irresponsible way they've been acting, they're not going to be able to come back from that. It's not going to be business as usual.
Increasingly, Moscow is saying that because of more heavy U.S. weapons coming to Ukraine, that this is more of a proxy fight between Russia and the U.S. Is it?
No, it's a fight between Russia, who attacked Ukraine, and Ukraine. We're helping Ukraine. But it's Ukraine's fight, and Ukraine's fighting it very well.
If Russia considers this a proxy fight, as it's publicly saying, are you worried about escalation? Because Moscow has said it would rather escalate than lose.
President Putin likes to throw out a lot of bluster and a lot of threats, and we can't choose our policy or decide our policy based on his threats. We have to base it on what the situation is and our commitment to help Ukraine win this fight.
So that sounds like no matter what kind of threats come out of Moscow, the U.S. will stay the course.
Yes.
Okay. And then lastly, as we said, this is your first visit to Lviv in 2 months. Some of your European counterparts have already returned to Kyiv. Why not return to Kyiv?
When they tell me it's safe to go back and bring my people back, I'll do it. Obviously, we're here, so we have made a certain determination that we can safely travel here. As soon as they tell me we can go back to Kyiv, we'll be there because we are very eager to go back.
Christina Kavin, thank you very much.
Good. Well, it's good to see you. Thank you.
And a note, our coverage of the war in Ukraine is supported in partnership with the Pulitzer Center.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. A federal jury in Washington, D.C. convicted a retired New York police officer of assault and other charges in the January 6, 2021 riot at the U.S. Capitol. Thomas Webster was found guilty of attacking a D.C. police officer with a flagpole. He claimed self-defense. Webster could get 20 years in prison on the assault charge alone. The January 6th Congressional Committee has asked three more Republican members of the U.S. House to testify. Congressman Andy Biggs of Arizona, Mo Brooks of Alabama, and Ronnie Jackson of Texas are being asked to appear voluntarily. All say they will not cooperate. The committee is seeking information about White House meetings and talks with then-President Trump. The biggest wildfire in the U.S. kept getting bigger today after destroying or damaging more than 170 homes in recent days. The fire burning in northeastern New Mexico has scorched 190 square miles. Fast-moving flames forced more people to leave today behind those who got out Sunday.
I got up in the morning at 6, and at that time, the smoke was still miles away. By 9 o'clock, 9:30, the smoke in the valley was so thick, he needed a butter knife to cut through it.
The evacuation order also included some 200 patients at a small psychiatric hospital. In Philadelphia, a former police officer was charged today with murdering a 12-year-old boy in March. Investigators say the boy, Thomas T.J. Sedario, had fired a shot at an unmarked car and wounded a plainclothes officer. But they say video shows he threw the gun away and was on the ground when Officer Edsel Mendoza shot and killed him. Mendoza has since been fired. Tennessee Governor Bill Lee declared a moratorium on executions today to allow an independent review of lethal injections. He said the state has not properly tested the drugs used for executions. The moratorium applies for the rest of the year. An Oklahoma judge is allowing a lawsuit seeking reparations for survivors and descendants of victims of the 1921 Tulsa Race Massacre to proceed. The plaintiff's attorney said today's ruling will help bring justice to the three remaining living survivors who are all over age 100. An estimated 100 to 300 people were killed and over 1,000 homes destroyed when a white mob descended on a part of town known as Black Wall Street. Still to come on the NewsHour, we examine the influence and increasingly extreme views of Fox News host Tucker Carlson. Our Politics Monday team weighs in on the start of the primary election season. A museum exhibit chronicles the career of a South African activist fighting for trans visibility, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Former President Trump's influence in this year's midterm elections gets its first big test in tomorrow's Republican primary for Ohio's U.S. Senate seat. As John Yang reports, Trump's surprise endorsement of a one-time self-proclaimed never-Trumper has shaken up the race.
Friday morning at Nana and Papa's Diner in Thornville, Ohio, about 40 miles east of Columbus. Time for this group's weekly breakfast. On the menu, eggs, French toast, biscuits and gravy, and on this last Friday before the primary election, a large side of politics.
I want to talk to you guys about the Senate race, the Senate primary on Tuesday.
The name that comes up again and again isn't even on the ballot. Donald Trump, who's backing Senate candidate J.D. Vance.
Trump stepped up and, you know, backed J.D. Vance, you know, so.
And that's what made the difference for you?
Absolutely.
I'm 100% behind Donald Trump, so, and that's who he recommended.
For most of the five major candidates, and polls show no clear frontrunner, it's been a contest who could seem the most like Trump.
President Trump fought for you. I'll do the same.
Who's the candidate that's the true America First candidate?
It's not good enough to elect Republicans.
Right.
We gotta elect the right kind of Republicans.
They tout Trump's issues, trade, immigration, and the 2020 election.
There's no doubt in my mind there was fraud.
Stealing the 2020 election.
I believe the 2020 election was stolen.
For some voters, like finance analyst Bob Beisel, who was at a Vance event near Columbus, that's a litmus test.
You're not a true, I would say, put America first, MAGA candidate if you feel that the 2020 election was fair.
The crowded Republican contest is getting far more attention than the Democratic primary, where Representative Tim Ryan is the heavy favorite.
This man is going to win. Come on up, J.D.
Last month in Delaware, Ohio, Trump personally blessed Vance's candidacy in the Republican primary.
Ohio, do we love this guy?
If you want to deliver a historic victory for America First here in Ohio, J.D. Vance is your guy.
That surprised many, since in 2016, Vance was a self-proclaimed never-Trumper. In an interview that year about his best-selling memoir, Hillbilly Elegy, Judy Woodruff asked Vance about Hillary Clinton's description of Trump supporters as a basket of deplorables.
Is there something to what she said, or is she completely off base?
Well, I think it's probably both. There is definitely an element of Donald Trump's support that has its basis in racism or xenophobia.
At a campaign event near Dayton last week, registered nurse Lisa Boucher asked Vance about his previous comments.
I just can't get past how much you hated Trump.
Even when I didn't like Trump personally, I liked a lot of what Trump talked about, and I liked a lot of what Trump stood for. And I think if you see what I was saying at the time, you would see the full spectrum of how I felt about it.
How concerned are you about the sort of skepticism we heard today?
I think some people were skeptical, some people aren't. At the end of the day, we're going to win the race.
Afterward, Boucher seemed unconvinced.
You can only sell yourself to a certain degree, and then for me, I'm going to go with my gut.
But for Job Scott, an auto worker from Southern Ohio, Vance's change of heart mirrors his own.
I think there was 15 people on the stage at one time, and I think he was my 15th choice. I'm just as guilty as J.D. Vance of not, you know, supporting Trump in the very beginning.
Ohio has always been typically a battleground state.
Scott and his brother-in-law, Kevin Black, who works in finance, are both backing Vance.
I liked where he came from. I liked that he came from poverty. A lot of adversity in his life. So I'd already made the decision. I mean, the Trump endorsement was just kind of an added bonus.
For Black, it helped seal the deal.
And if he puts his faith and some other big-name players are putting their reputation behind J.D., then I got to trust what they're saying.
I'm going to Washington to be reinforcements for fighters.
Many observers expected former state treasurer Josh Mandel to get the Trump endorsement. In his third run for the U.S. Senate, Mandel has been a steadfast crusader for Trump's agenda. Though in Nebraska yesterday, Trump seemed confused about just who he endorsed.
We've endorsed J.P., right? J.D. Mandel, and he's doing great.
Mandel is backed by Texas Senator Ted Cruz.
We need the warrior to stand and fight.
I'm going to work very closely with President
Mandel, who often campaigns in evangelical churches, met reporters with Cruz before an appearance near Dayton.
What do you see in Josh Mandel that President Trump didn't see?
It's easy for a candidate to say the right things. What I look for is, what is the candidate's record? When have they stood and fought and bled?
Other candidates also claim a link with the former president. Attorney Jane Timken was handpicked by Trump to lead the Ohio Republican Party.
A lot of the candidates in this race, all of a sudden, they've seen the light and they are fighting for those America First policies, but I'm the true fighter.
Mike Gibbons, a millionaire investment banker, touts a Trump-like personal history.
When I get to Washington, I will not owe anything to anybody. I cannot be bought. I've already achieved my American dream.
Of the leading candidates, only State Senator Matt Dolan did not seek Trump's support.
I'm the one in the race that's talking about executing. Everyone else is talking about making noise. I know who I'm fighting for, what I'm fighting for. These guys just want to create fights.
This cantankerous contest is a sharp contrast to Ohio's recent tradition of mainstream statewide Republican office holders.
Senator Rob Portman.
That includes the man whose Senate seat is at stake, Rob Portman, a free trade, free market champion who's retiring. Last year, he helped negotiate the bipartisan $1 trillion infrastructure deal signed by President Biden.
Senator Rob Portman is a really hell of a good guy. I'm not hurting you, Rob, because I know you're not running again. That's the only reason I say it.
What's changed? Vance voters Job Scott and Kevin Black have differing theories.
The Ronald Reagan Republican wasn't so divisive. He didn't do anything to make anyone divisive. And I think Trump Republican has to be divisive.
I'm going to say complete opposite. I'm going to say the voters haven't changed. I haven't changed. We're the same hardworking Christian, Constitution, American patriotic. That's the base of the Republican Party.
So you don't think there's a difference between the Ronald Reagan Republican and the Donald Trump Republican?
Much of Ohio, especially here in the rural areas, still seems to be very much Trump country. And at places like Nana and Papa's, there's no doubt about Trump's influence on the primary election. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang in Thornville, Ohio.
Every night, more than 3 million people tune in to Tucker Carlson's show on the Fox News Channel. It is the most watched cable news show. Last year it was. A new analysis from the New York Times explores how Carlson is using his platform. Amna Nawaz has more.
Judy, as the New York Times describes it, for the past 5 years and more than 1,100 hours of TV, Carlson's rating success has been built by weaponizing fears and grievances of his audience to create, quote, what may be the most racist show in the history of cable news. To help explain Carlson's influence, Nick Confessori joins us. He's a political and investigative reporter at the New York Times and the author of that assessment. Nick, welcome back to the NewsHour. Thanks for making the time. I think it's fair to say part of Mr. Carlson's rating success is built on leaning into sort of an us versus them narrative. He seems to relish the fight and the criticism and attention, so much so, in fact, when your articles came out, he tweeted a photo of himself sort of gleefully holding up the front page of the New York Times. I guess my first question is, why devote so much time and energy to him? Are you worried at all about feeding that narrative?
It's a great question, Amna. Look, he's a singularly important person in the modern right now. He's the inheritor of the MAGA tradition, or the nativist tradition, that Donald Trump seized and rode to the White House. He's the highest rated cable show host in history. And it's also the most racist show in history. He has done something that no other host has ever done. And I'm not saying that lightly. It's a big claim, and I'll tell you what it's based on. Every night, that show teaches fear and loathing. He may claim to be a person who opposes racism and prejudice, but what the show tells you every night is to be afraid. To be afraid of people who are in the street asking for police officers to not shoot black people. Be afraid of Afghan refugees who helped us in the war who are coming over here now. To be afraid of Dr. Fauci, and to be afraid of immigration in general, which he posits is part of a cabal, a plot to destroy Western civilization.
You know, Nick, it's interesting because these have not always been his views. We should remind folks he's had a long history, a long career in television. He's been through multiple networks. He had a show at MSNBC and CNN, right here on PBS, a short-lived show as well. He's offering sort of a conservative, libertarian point of view. But you have written that he's never written extensively about exactly when and why his views changed, but clues are sprinkled throughout his career. So tell me about those clues. How do you understand that evolution of what brought him to his views today?
Well, if you watch his stated views over time, what really surprised me in reporting we did was how far back it goes. For the first few years of his career, in his 20s, when he was a rising magazine writer, he wasn't much of an ideologue. He was more of a humorist. And then after 9/11, pretty soon after that, he was staking out pretty stern views on immigration. At the time, more conventional views against immigration, saying we need better, border security after 9/11. Not a crazy idea, widely shared at the time. Within a few years after that, on his MSNBC show, he's saying, of course immigration at the southern border is an invasion. How could you deny that? It's an invasion. And over time after that, he bombs out of cable for the first time. He starts the Daily Caller. And within the Daily Caller, that magazine, there's a debate there among the traditional kinds of conservatism, the Reagan-era style conservatism, and the new populism that even before Donald Trump kind of runs for president is bubbling up on the right and is sort of becoming the dominant force. He sees that. He seizes it. He's early to see that Donald Trump has what it takes to win the nomination and the presidency. And he more or less embraces the core idea of Trumpism, which is that these people are coming and taking your country away from you, and you should be afraid.
So among some of that messaging, right, featured prominently and frequently on his show, phrases and ideas that are really core to the racist white nationalist movement, right? The idea that people who believe this should be a homeland just for white people. You actually feature a sort of montage of some of those moments in your reporting. Just take a listen to this clip.
So anti-white racism is exploding across the country.
White men, they're the problem.
They hate white men more than they hate global warming.
Those white men, Raytheon said, must, quote, step aside for minorities. As soon as we get rid of all these white men, everything will be great. White backlash, white resistance, white, meaning evil, cruel, and bigoted. So shut up, white man.
Nick, why is this a message that Fox would want on its air?
It's great for ratings. Fox's audience is only 8% non-white. And it's, I believe it's 80% 55 and older. So it's predominantly an old white audience, people who grew up in a time when this country was much less diverse, when white people were 80% of the country, 70% of the country. And I think there's fear there. There's anxiety about losing power, losing preeminence in American public life and politics. And what he's done, and the reason, it's not just the anti-white racism kind of rhetoric on the show. He's literally taking ideas that began on the very far right, on arcane corners of the internet, on neo-Nazi sites, replacement theory, the idea that there's a cabal in America of elite leaders and business leaders and politicians who are not just in favor of more immigration. They're trying to populate the country with obedient voters from the quote-unquote third world so that they can have control of the country. That's not having an argument about borders and immigration policy. That's taking a white nationalist conspiracy theory and putting it on the air on TV's top-rated cable show.
Nick, he's also aggressively defended January 6th insurrectionists and played down how violent that day actually was. On that point, actually, like a lot of programming on Fox, he's very much in line with the Republican Party and their message. What did your reporting find about that relationship between the GOP and Tucker Carlson?
Look, I would say he is the high priest of Trumpism. President Trump has been out of office since January 2021. He's been banned from Twitter and Facebook for a while. I think Tucker Carlson has filled the vacuum, kind of the media vacuum of Trump's absence. And one way he has done it is to re-spin what happened on January 6th as a new lost cause. And he's done it on half the episodes he did, almost half the episodes in 2021. He basically kind of recaptured and restated what happened. He said that these people were victims. They were lured in as part of a honeypot scheme. Entrapment by the FBI. They had real grievances because the election really was stolen and nothing really bad happened that day. He's told that story over and over and over again. He's tried to make the aggressors on January 6th into the victims.
What about a response from Tucker Carlson himself or from Fox? Have you gotten that in response to your reporting?
He declined an interview. He said on his show last week that, you know, I was trying to shut him up, that I'm a bad dinner party guest, which really unfair. I mean, I'm a really fun dinner party guest. I'm a really good time at dinners. He says now he hasn't read the story. He seems very well informed about the story from comments he's made since it came out. I don't know if he's read it. Fox defends him, but of course they defend him. He's the money guy. He's bought in more advertising revenue in every year since 2018 than any other show on Fox, despite all those ad boycotts.
That is Nick Confessori, investigative reporter from the New York Times, joining us tonight. Nick, always good to see you. Thank you.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Republicans will be closely watching Ohio's primary election tomorrow, and there are reports that Democrats are considering revamping their midterm strategy to draw a stronger contrast between themselves and the Trump wing of the GOP. To discuss all that and more, it's a good time to check in with our Politics Monday team. That's Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter, and Annie Linsky of the Washington Post. She's sitting in tonight for Tamara Keith. Hello to both of you. So good to see you on this Monday. Time to talk about politics. Well, Amy, let's start with what we just heard Amna talking to Nick Confessori about, this three-part mega report on Tucker Carlson. Clarify for us, what is Tucker Carlson's role in the Republican Party, in American politics?
I mean, I think that Nick Confessori put it really well when he said that he's filling the void that had been left by Donald Trump's voice being off of social media. And he's not in the White House, obviously, so he's not there every minute, every day in the way that he used to. He's also being talked about as a potential 2024 candidate for president, and that's not idle discussion. I think his name will be very seriously floated, and we may see more to come of a Tucker Carlson trial balloon in 2024.
I wonder if former President Trump is aware of that.
Well, I'm sure he
is. We suspect that he is. Annie Linsky, what about, I mean, how do you see this Tucker Carlson phenomenon right now?
Well, I think one of the parts of Nick's reporting that resonated the most with me is this idea that Carlson is really sort of at the nexus of both, you know, media and influence, but also kind of a quieter influence with candidates in particular. Mm-hmm. And he has been a promoter of J.D. Vance in Ohio, which I know we'll talk about later. But and I find that to be a particular role of, you know, he's using both his voice as his platform to sort of put out new ideas, but also just bolster candidates. And so he is kind of in a almost, you don't want to say kingmaker role, but his influence is extreme, is, you know, out there.
It's significant.
Significant. Thank you.
Is it, Amy, a matter of saying if you don't get Tucker Carlson's blessing, then it's a problem for you as a Republican?
Well, we'll see. I mean, you know, he's gone after, much like Donald Trump has, people who he sees are out of step or out of line with his overall philosophy or have done things that have gone against whatever Tucker doesn't like. Many of them were still successful. One person he's been really consistently against, at least recently, has been Kevin McCarthy. I don't think anyone expects to see, if Republicans take the House, that he's not going to be the Speaker. But his influence, the conversation about it, is important.
And Annie, what the darker side of this, which we heard in that conversation about race and about the role of the threat that many white Americans feel. What does that say about our politics right now?
I think that was one of the most sort of stunning takeaways, for me at least, from that New York Times reporting, which was just so incredible. It's just the extent to which they really documented the ways in which Carlson is normalizing discussions of race that I think would not be considered, are not considered appropriate in many parts of the country. But Carlson's show is moving sort of the window to where they're becoming more appropriate. And I think that's what many groups on the left worry about. And I think that is what the Times' reporting is kind of showing, is really the danger that Tucker Carlson and his show presents, is making it more okay to have those kinds of grievances voiced out loud. And that, you know, that to me is what the worry is.
And that brings us to Ohio, we want to talk about, because we had John Yang's report, right. Amy. And there you have Donald Trump's enormous influence. Absolutely. In a race where the candidate who he has blessed seems to be doing very well.
Or seems to have some momentum.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was reporting on this race earlier, I was watching all the ads that the candidates were putting up on air, and it was basically a noun, a verb, and Donald Trump, right? Everything had to involve Donald Trump. What's more remarkable, I think, is what John alluded to, is the really diminished role of the senator who's leaving. Rob Portman, senator who's been there since 2010, has also endorsed a candidate. But his candidate has gotten absolutely no traction. Mm-hmm. And it's also really remarkable to think that it wasn't that long ago, in 2016, that John Kasich easily won the primary in Ohio over Donald Trump, that somebody like a Rob Portman could win. And in fact, he ran 7 points ahead of Donald Trump in 2016 in the general election. Those folks, they no longer exist in Ohio.
So we'll see what happens in Ohio, Annie. But of course, people are saying, so is this going to happen in every Republican primary? No way to know that right now.
Yeah.
But it may not be the case. But Donald Trump is still a factor.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, J.D. Vance was sort of lagging behind in this campaign until Donald Trump went in and endorsed him. And you saw a Fox News poll that came out shortly after the endorsement. His support was, I believe, it doubled. I mean, it was just an incredible jump. So I do think ultimately none of us have a crystal ball. We don't know what's going to happen. The polling has kind of been difficult to follow. But you definitely saw that Trump had an impact and really pushed J.D. Vance, at least into a poll position where he could win.
Yeah, and there are so many other states we're watching these primaries, Pennsylvania.
Yes.
And others where you have the
Georgia.
Georgia and others. I do quickly want to turn both of you to a story in Politico today, inside reporting that the White House is looking at structuring their midterm strategy around going against who else? Donald Trump and his wing of the Republican Party. What does that say to you?
It says they do not want, Democrats do not want this election to be what midterms traditionally are, which is a referendum on the sitting president and the party in charge. Not when the president is underwater in terms of his job approval rating, people feeling anxious about the state of the economy. They want to turn it to, let's make it a choice. Now, this isn't unique. This isn't new. Republicans tried the same thing in 2018. Yeah. They ran more ads, Republicans did, about Nancy Pelosi than Democrats ran about Donald Trump.
We remember that.
You remember that? Yeah. She was the centerpiece. Republicans still lost 40 seats in the House that year. So it's very difficult to change the trajectory away from a referendum. But what Democrats are really hoping is in these individual races, whether it's Pennsylvania, Arizona, those candidates who have the Trump support, have embraced Trump, have embraced many of his policies, that's going to be a bigger liability than the big picture conversation.
And in just a few seconds, Annie, we don't know that they're going to do this, but it wouldn't be shocking, I think.
Oh, absolutely. We should also mention that Democrats just tried to do this in Virginia and tried to make, you know, Glenn Youngkin into Donald Trump, and that was not a winning strategy. So, you know, Joe Biden had tacked away from that strategy and had presented himself as more of a unifier in the State of the Union. But now we're tacking again to being a little bit more Democrats versus Republicans. So the White House is clearly scrambling around for a message that they think could work.
It is already May. We are in primary
We have
season.
Lots of primaries.
Lots of primaries to watch. Amy Walter, Annie Linsky, thank you both. Politics Monday. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Workers at an Amazon site today in Staten Island, New York, appeared to reject a union by a margin of nearly 2-1. William Brangham gets the latest on this and larger efforts.
That's right, Judy. What's known as the Amazon Labor Union lost its unionizing vote today. That loss comes just weeks after they'd scored a historic win at a much larger neighboring Amazon warehouse, which created the first ever union at the massive online company. Amazon has battled hard with unions, including a recent contested fight in Alabama. But there are now union drives springing up at other major employers as well, including at a number of Starbucks, Apple stores, and REI stores around the country. For some perspective on all of this, I'm joined by Maximilian Alvarez. He's editor-in-chief at the Real News Network and host of the Working People podcast. Maximilian, great to have you on the NewsHour. Help us understand what went down today, because as I mentioned, several weeks ago, this tiny union wins a historic victory against Amazon, but then today loses at a much smaller facility. How do you explain that reversal of fortune? How should we see that?
Well, thank you so much for having me on the show, and thank you for taking an interest in this vital topic. I'm really glad that it's getting the attention it deserves. I think it's important for us to first remember why it was such a historic victory when the independent Amazon Labor Union successfully voted to unionize at the JFK 8 Fulfillment Center on Staten Island, an 8,000-plus person facility. Historic for a number of reasons. One, it is traditionally very, very hard to organize your workplace in this country. After decades of labor law being stacked in favor of the bosses, workers are really up against an uphill battle. Second, they were going up against the second largest private employer in the United States, one of the most powerful companies in the world. Amazon is an international behemoth that we have no democratic say over whatsoever. So workers were really taking on Goliath there. On top of that, they were building a union while they were doing it. They didn't have an institutional union infrastructure. And so it was really a rank and file effort. And it was that worker-to-worker organizing that allowed them to convince enough people to vote yes for the union and achieve that historic victory last month. But in the month since that happened, between these two elections, right, Amazon has a chance to regroup. Amazon is trying to challenge the National Labor Relations Board and throw out the first election results. At the same time, they are, you know, paying union-busting consultants over $400 an hour to tell workers who are making $18.25 an hour that they don't deserve more. These outside consultants are telling them that the union is an outside party that's going to get in between them and management. And the other thing is that workers at this second facility are largely part-time. They're main concern is to get more hours so that they can, you know, make ends meet. And so when you're already living that close to the edge, the thought of losing this election, of facing more retaliation, may actually scare you more than it did the workers at the first facility.
The other argument that Amazon makes to the workers is, look, we pay you well, we offer benefits, there's no need for a union, just talk to us directly. And I know people, I've interviewed people who have gone to Amazon and found good jobs and benefits there. But this movement continues, and Amazon has pushed very hard against the union. As I mentioned, they've also had this big fight in Bessemer, Alabama. Can you just quickly remind us of what that fight was and the status of that?
Absolutely. Yeah, I was down in Bessemer this time last year for the Real News Network talking to workers and organizers there. It was a different situation where workers at another massive fulfillment center, over 5,000 workers in a deindustrialized majority black town with twice the national poverty rate in Bessemer. And so Amazon workers were making more than the average Bessemer citizen, but they were still getting chewed up and spit out. There are people all over this country and all over this world whose bodies have been broken by working at Amazon, and that is part of its business model. On average, Amazon warehouses have a turnover rate of 150%. So a lot of the workers who started a union organizing campaign aren't going to be there by the time that campaign ends. That was part of what Bessemer workers were fighting against. They held a union election with the RWDSU. They failed the first election, but the National Labor Relations Board ruled that Amazon had illegally tampered with that election. So they got another shot at it. They voted already. The results are kind of in limbo right now because there are a number of challenged ballots that could sway the election one way or the other. So that's where things currently stand in Bessemer.
Put these Amazon fights into context with the national labor movement. As I mentioned, we're seeing other sprouts of organizing at Starbucks, at Apple stores, at REI, places that have not traditionally had much union penetration. Is this an actual sea change going on in the labor movement or something else?
I do think that, and what I'm hearing from workers as I talk to them for The Real News and my show Working People all the time, is there is a rising labor consciousness. People know they've been getting screwed over for a long time. Workers for the past 40 years have been more productive than they've ever been, yet workers' wages have largely stagnated over that period while the 1% is pocketing all of that extra generated revenue, right? So, and cost of living keeps going up. We're in an inflation squeeze right now. And then we also hit a pandemic where it was made very clear that workers were going to be paraded as essential as a sort of PR tactic, but they got no say over their safety conditions, and people are rebelling against that, whether that is quitting their jobs in record numbers, what we're calling the Great Resignation, whether that is like massive historic unionization efforts at places like Starbucks and Amazon, whether that is unions that already exist getting more militant and hitting the picket line like Kellogg's, like in academia, so on and so forth. So I think there are a number of reasons why people are standing up, but I do think that they're looking at each other and they are building on the successes of each other, and they're learning from the failures, and that is what I think makes this more of a movement than just kind of random pockets of activity happening simultaneously.
Maximilian Alvarez, the podcast is Working People Podcast. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you, William. And one more note, Amazon turned down our request for an interview on the elections and the criticism. But a company spokeswoman said in a statement, quote, "We're glad that our team at LDJ5, that's the Staten Island warehouse, were able to have their voices heard. We look forward to continuing to work directly together as we strive to make every day better for our employees." Sir Zanele Moholi of South Africa has been documenting queer and trans people in that country for decades. Describing themselves as a visual activist, Moholi aims to celebrate life, joy, and the beauty of the community. Muholi's work is being shown across the country and the world this spring. Special correspondent Jared Bowen of public station GBH reports on one exhibit in Boston for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
This is Sir Zanelli Muholi at work, intent that people be seen and acknowledged. In picture after picture, Muholi wants us to take in their pride, their togetherness, their very being.
All I ever wanted to do was to make sure that I become the voice for change in South Africa, in which every second being who is Black, who is queer, who is trans, is documented in South Africa.
For nearly 20 years, Muholi has been photographing LGBTQIA plus people in South Africa. In the aftermath of apartheid, it was the first nation in the world to outlaw discrimination based on sexual orientation. But that community remains subject to high rates of violence and murder, especially among young and Black people. Muholi has used photography to change the culture.
It's like you cannot dare to ignore it. It's Black, it's beautiful, it's in your walls, and it forces you to wonder, how can you, as a white person, deal with the Black image, deal with Black people in your spaces, deal with Black colleagues in your workplace.
Their work, stemming from their role as a self-described visual activist, is on view at Boston's Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum.
You see a sense of undeniable pride that comes from a confidence in being.
Theo Tyson is the show's co-curator, and the work became even more layered, Tyson says, when Muholi began creating stylized self-portraits in 2012, part of a series shot all over the world called Sunyama Gunyama, translated from Zulu as Hail the Dark Lioness.
They're not playing dress-up. The costumery, if you will, is part of the storytelling. There are clothespins used to talk about domestic labor and share stories of their mother, luggage wrap that's used to talk about issues with travel, racism, colorism. There are the plastic gloves that we see in sort of this signs of the times and what that represents, from sexual violence to access to health care to now COVID and what we need to do to protect ourselves.
Originally, you didn't necessarily turn the camera on yourself. What was the genesis of that?
I guess that after many years of documenting other people or photographing other people, I needed to remember me. I wanted to pay homage to my mom. Her spirit forever lives with me. If she didn't suffer from labor pains for me to be born, we won't be having this conversation right now.
In these images, Muholi also increases the contrast of their skin tone in post-production. It's yet another conversation with the viewer, Muholi says.
This is just engagement. How far can we go with our bodies? How far can we go with our voices? How fearful are we to say what makes us feel uncomfortable? So are we brave enough to face the world out there that doesn't allow us to be either as Black, either as queer folks, either as anything?
The exhibition also features Muholi's latest work, their first sculpture, and paintings never before seen in a museum. Pirana Cavalcini is the show's co-curator.
It's so exciting, you know, this idea of still, you know, dealing with different characters and archetypes, and also connecting the painting to the photography in very interesting ways.
Cavalcini came to know Muholi during their time as one of the museum's artists in residence in 2019, and during a trip with Tyson to Cape Town last year. The show, she says, paints the duality of Muholi.
Being Muholi, portraits as resistance, is the idea of letting Muholi be. So it's Muholi as an artist activist, very powerfully so. But at the same time, there's humanity. You know, there's that sense of vulnerability.
Which Muholi readily talks about. The paintings were mostly made last year during a period of pain. So these works were a way of healing, even if they're sold at the end of the day.
What's different is the color. So for once, I was like trying to dive out of the, you know, the drowning.
Well, what did you see when you stepped back after you'd completed these paintings and saw the color?
It's very interesting. You fall in love knowing that you might lose that lover, you know? And once it's out of your sight and it belongs to the other. So it's like losing love, and that love belongs to someone, and you wonder if you'll ever like touch it again.
But being Muholi means that love was fully realized. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jared Bowen in Boston.
Some breaking news while we've been on the air. Politico reports tonight that the U.S. Supreme Court is poised to strike down Roe v. Wade, the landmark case that made abortion legal in 1973. The outlet cites an initial draft of a majority opinion written by Justice Samuel Alito in February. Alito wrote, quote, "It is time to heed the Constitution and return the issue of abortion to the people's elected representatives." The court's decision could yet change and will not be final until it is published. In a statement to the NewsHour, the court said it has no comment. The NewsHour has not independently confirmed Politico's report. And we will have more updates as we get it on this developing news on our website. That's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Stephanie Tsai. Good evening and take care.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at MacFound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.